anesthetic vibes.
Okay. Hey everyone, today I'm with Paige and we're going to be talking about a very specific part of anesthesia, which is why it's better to keep a patient deep rather than light. So Paige, now, what do you reckon? So we've got a patient having an LMA anesthetic, so they're not paralyzed, and we're just kind of talking about why it's better to keep someone deep, which is not really intuitive. Mostly medicine, most of the time, with medications, you want to start low and go slow. But in the induction of certain patients who are fit and well, and you know, the induction of anesthesia, let's talk about why it's better to keep them deep rather than light. And this also applies to sometimes during the anesthetic itself, especially if they're not paralyzed. What are the problems of a patient being too light?
Their reaction, I guess. Muscle contraction,
they absolutely
can curl up, and then respiratorize, it can have laryngospasm or...
Fantastic. So muscle contraction can happen, so they're reacting to the stimulus of whatever you're doing. So if the abdominal muscles react, what can that do?
It can vomit and aspirate. They
absolutely
clench your abdomen.
Exactly. So that's right. Their stomach contracts, increases intra-abdominal pressure. You now have a pressure gradient from your stomach up to your mouth, so you can get aspiration, and that's obviously a really big problem. That's your abdominal muscle contraction. How about your upper airway muscle contraction? What are the problems that could happen there?
Teeth-wise, they can clench down.
Yep, absolutely.
Right up the airway, that makes it a bit difficult. And
that's right, so their teeth clench. That means I can't put a laryngoscope in. I can't open the mouth to put an LMA in, or even a Gadel in, and that's difficult. And likewise, your thoracic muscle contract, it's hard to ventilate against that. So again, light anesthesia, a bit of a problem. What other structures there?
Larynx, they could have laryngospasm.
Absolutely, and I don't know if you've ever had a laryngospasm, but that's bad enough in itself. There's so many things you have to do to solve it. But if the patient's easy enough to solve, but if the patient takes a really deep breath against laryngospasm, you've suddenly got this negative intrathoracic pressure and no air can relieve that pressure, so what could happen?
Negative pressure pulmonary edema.
That's the one. So the fluid goes from your pulmonary capillaries into your lungs, causes negative pressure pulmonary edema, and that could be a serious problem. So, fantastic. So if the patient's too light, muscle contraction stuff, abdominal, thoracic, and airway can cause all of these problems. Obviously a really bad idea. So that's the light problems. How about deep anesthetic? What are the problems of too deep anesthesia?
I guess a too deep anesthesia can cause respiratory depression.
Yep.
Which could be difficult in terms of your ventilation, but you can always go to your bag valve ventilation.
That's right. So you can have respiratory... If the patient's too deep, they'll have ventilatory compromise and apnea. But that's pretty easy to treat because I've already got an LMA in, and so you can easily ventilate the patient and solve that problem, especially if you're airway trained and qualified and you're an anaesthetist. How about the other problems? So there's airway problems and respiratory problems with too much depth of anesthesia?
Yeah. I guess the other one would be cardiovascular problems that you can run into.
Absolutely. What happens with the cardiovascular problems?
Usually hypotension and bradycardia could be complications of going too deep.
Exactly. Hypotension and bradycardia. So these are obviously a problem. They're not great. And in a fit young patient having a bit of hypotension and bradycardia, how do you treat that?
You can use some of your inotropes or vasopressors.
Fantastic.
To help pump them up.
Beautiful. And which ones do you know of?
Metaraminol. And then ephedrine.
That's the one, good.
Cheap man's adrenaline.
Beautiful. Poor man's adrenaline, cheap man's adrenaline. So metaraminol, that's an easy vasopressor to use. And here we go, ephedrine, easy enough to use. So these are really easy solutions, I'd say. So let's put that in context. If someone is too light, I've got the aspiration risk, laryngospasm, airway problems, intrathoracic pressure problems and ventilation. Those are those problems. Now think about a fit young patient with a bit of hypertension, ephedrine, aramine, which one's easier to solve?
The too deep.
Yeah, the too deep. Now, that's just this general thing that a lot of anaesthetists talk about. It's far easier to have a patient who's generally well, you know, like up to a middle-aged patient, generally well of a normal weight, having them deep. The problems of depth are easier to solve than the problems of light anesthesia. But always this comes with an extra precaution. If someone's really old, frail, bad cardiac status, you know, heart failure, ischemic heart disease, maybe they've got, you know, massive blood loss and they're hemorrhaging, then you've really got to, you know, have that fine balance. So, you know, depth of anesthesia has to be really managed carefully, and too deep is, you know, can be completely hazardous. So definitely be cautious with what I've said there. In most well patients, most circumstances, it's far better to have them deep than light.
What's your definition of kind of well in young patient?
Yeah, so let's say anything, when you do an induction, most people roughly do 2 milligrams per kilogram of propofol. In some young, fit patients of a certain weight, you may need even more than that. For example, in kids, you often need 4 milligrams, you know, 2 to 4 milligrams per kilogram. And in some young patients, I would give, you know, two, three, even 4 milligrams per kilogram of propofol. Always knowing that, you know, it's better to keep them deep and always having aramine or metaraminol and ephedrine ready. In terms of the volatile concentration I have during the case, I'd always run them at least a MAC just to be sure that they're nice and deep. And sometimes, you know, in some cases, I'd run it even higher. So some people would tend to get patients a 1.1, 1.2 MAC even, just to be sure that they're really still for the procedure. Okay, so that's it. Just to wrap up, in most patients who fit well and robust without cardiac problems, without, you know, cardiovascular issues, it is far better to keep them deep and light. The problems of depth of anesthesia are easier to solve than the problems of light anesthesia. Cool. See you next time.